So it's not enough to know just the transcript. They may have a special way to refer to transcript, although they usually are referred to distinctly as a transcript. You can usually work on the pagination of the transcript. But the rest of the record, you're going to need to go visit and see that index. And to tell you the truth, I usually share that with opposing counsel. I go in there, I make notes on their transcript of where each entry begins on the page, and I send that over. And I do that for two reasons. One is it's a not decent thing to do. The other is they can check and they call me back if I've been nice to them. They'll say, by the way, you got a page wrong here. So do that kind of thing. You find something's missing. What do? The place to correct the record is in the trial court. And I swear I have this frequently happen. Sealed transcripts seem to be a real puzzler for court clerks. Well, it was sealed, so they must not have ever looked at it. It can't be part of the record. Jesus. You file a motion, usually actually you call opposing counsel. You see if you can work it out to have the record supplemented to include any evidence or transcript or other thing that is omitted. Every once in a while, there'll be a correction needed. I have had transcription taken down that's absolutely flat wrong. And the other side agrees. And we will stipulate to the record being corrected that way. But there's a procedure under the appellate court rules where you go to the trial court to have that done. 9 out of 10 times I've had the cooperation of opposing counsel on that. And you especially want to look for if there's been some sort of motion on to suppress, granted, and evidence not allowed in, that somehow may not have worked its way into the record, which needed to be in there. It was offered in connection with the motion. You want to watch that to make sure it did not get omitted by accident because somebody just didn't pull it in because it didn't get in. That's part of the record. I didn't go to the jury, but it is part of the record. The last thing, and we're going to have plenty of time for questions, but I'm going to go off the reservation a little bit. I'm going to ask you to do something. You're about to engage in an amazing thing, I think. Criminal work is the most interesting work I ever have done. Appellate work is some of the most important criminal work you can do. We shouldn't be here today. This is a failure of our legislature to have any decent leadership. You're about to encounter, and I don't have any doubt, provide the most able, outstanding assistance to these folks we could have. But the fact that we are in a room getting people to volunteer speaks to a funding failure in the legislature when the funds have been up. As you work, I hope you develop a sensitivity to the importance of your work and that you consider how important it would be for having people within the system as it was designed to carry out that work so it's funded fully and not by virtue of the good grace of amazing people like you. That's your choice. But this is a vital issue where, as the Pakistani lawyers showed when they stood up and marched, when that Supreme Court was sent down. But there's been a failure of our leadership. You will be positioned better than anyone else to know how much we need your work, how much that vital importance is, and how much it's an obligation of the state to provide. I hope you take some time to consider those issues and whichever way you come down. And God knows there's no right or wrong in making our system work. There are a lot of different ways to skin the cat. But don't do your work and walk away. You're touching on something that is a very important part of our system. The very first vote I took as a member of the Board of Governors was to recommend implementation of what is now the statewide Indigent Defense System. It's the proudest vote I took. We set up a mechanism to fully fund it. That those funds have not been provided. Those funds were diverted. Talk to your political leaders. The leadership and the council is hamstrung. And of course, I've got to work with those folks in a way that you don't. So you're in a position to be much more free with your thoughts than they are. So probation, that's not authorized, that's not representative of anybody here. I'm bad for saying that, but it's what I believe more than anything, that we need to do as the next step, and that is to provide this as an ongoing basis. I think we now have a facilitator for questions.
Anybody have any questions about some of the things that we talked about? Is everybody awake?
Robert, I just had a comment, taking off on something that Tom said, you know, about dealing with opposite counsel. Actually, appellate litigation is a wonderful opportunity to exercise professionalism. I've realized this fairly recently when, I don't know, I was in a position of having to ask the Court of Appeals for an extension, and I knew the other side, and it was going to put the other side in the middle of a holiday, and I knew they were going to ask for an extension. And that brought the realization to me that, you know, in large measure, we two lawyers were on the same side, and that, you know, our opponent mutually was the Court of Appeals and what it was going to do to us. But what Tom said about furnishing the index, talking about stipulations, both sides are going to, you know, have problems like that, where something was intended to get into the record, for some reason or another didn't get into it. And I think doing appellate law is kind of like playing chess. There are not really any concealed moves, as there might be in a trial context, where you do play games of ambush and that sort of thing, and seek that kind of immediate advantage. But on appeal, everything is there in the record, you know, that you can't, if it's not there, it didn't happen. It's just like in a chess game, everything's out in the open. No moves are concealed. The motives may be, and where you're going may be concealed, but there are a lot of advantages with operating with your opponent on a friendly basis at that particular level. You can find your back scratched as often as you're scratching the office.
And you know, the other thing about this is, a long time ago when I clerked for Supreme Court Judge in Savannah, a guy who has influenced me considerably in my life as a lawyer, but he talked about criminal defense lawyers in Savannah, and he was explaining the difference between, you know, having a motion hearing on summary judgment and reading those briefs, and like a motion to suppress with the DA, a defense lawyer. At least in Savannah, he said, you know, the criminal defense lawyers and the DA, they just don't do a lot of good written work. This is a good opportunity for all of you, who I'm sure are good writers, to put that into a much needed area, which is putting together very well written appellate briefs, even though they deal with, you know, criminal issues. I remember that was a need, and even in my circuit, a lot of the lawyers who are not in my office who do a lot of criminal work don't do or like to write. And, you know, and in my opinion, to be an effective lawyer, it's not just giving a great closing argument or doing great oral argument in an appellate court, but writing is also really important. This is a good opportunity to hone those skills and provide them in a much needed arena. Any other comments or questions? Yes, sir.
Would you give us a sense of what to expect our relationship with trial counsel to be like? As we're going through this, what can we expect trial counsel to help with?
That's an excellent question. Any guys want to start?
It'll vary. I mean, I'm sorry, it varies. For the most part, they get it, in my experience. They understand that a critical avenue of defense for their client will be ineffective assistance of counsel, and they will acknowledge where they had done things incorrectly as opposed to, and not have a strategic, but it varies. You'll find some folks who see a malpractice claim come, and they get real, no way. Won't help you at all. So I wish I could say, but it just varies. Attracting more lies with honey than vinegar, so you just start out being nice and say, come on, help me. See if you make it a cooperative venture.
Chris? I have nothing to add to what Tom said. It's entirely consistent with the range of my experience. We were talking about this earlier, I became the appellate division of my office because trial counsel hated people. They try cases, they lose. they file a motion for new, the skeletal motion for new trial, then they bring me the file and say, here, I hate appeals. So I started doing all the appeals in my office. So you'll get guys who are like, oh, thank God, I don't have to do the appeal. Or you'll get guys who'll say, are you gonna let it affect it? And, you know, most professional lawyers will say, let me explain to you what I did, we can talk about it. But some of them get really defensive. So that's exactly right in the barrier. Yes, sir.
So what are steps you can take if you can't get the, they're uncooperative and you can't get their trial record?
I think that's a tough question. If they're just not cooperating, first of all, I think that, I might be wrong on this, but let's say they're saying, I'm not going to talk to you and I'm not going to provide you my file. I think the file belongs to the client.
And, you know, the state bar will love you to extract it from them.
you know, what's tough about that is, let's say that you think there's a legitimate ineffective assistance claim. And so you've got to have their live person at this hearing we've been talking about. You know, and if they won't talk to you ahead of time, it can be tough, because maybe the only way you get them there is to file a subpoena. And the first time you get to talk about the case is with that lawyer on the stand. I know one lawyer, Michael Edwards, is the chief public defender in Chatham County, which is in Savannah. And he and I were talking about some of these issues last week, and he said there's one particular lawyer, when you deal with her, she is hostile, she will not talk to you, and if you subpoena put her on the stand, she will try everything she can be, everything she can do to still be hostile on the stand and gut your claim. Some lawyers are very proprietary, I guess, about that stuff. That's a tough situation. And you know, you're kind of stuck having to use subpoena powers to deal with it.
Conversely, I've got a case where I've got to winnow all the ineffective assistance claims trial counsel has suggested to me.
Gerard. Bringing up subpoenas, I can't tell you the number of times lawyers in my office have had ineffective raised against them by outside counsel. And they're like, I've never been subpoenaed. I think generally we think, hey, we can trust the lawyer to show up, but basically all I do every day is raise ineffective on other lawyers, and the last thing I want to do is be ineffective myself. I subpoena every trial counsel, no matter how friendly they are with me, because, I mean, you just never know, and if something comes up, you need that to get continuous. So I subpoena the friendly ones, the unfriendly ones, I subpoena them all.
I have an assistant in my office who's much older than I and had a lot more experience than I. You said ineffective assistance to him, or about his performance, he would throw things. I mean, you can see a red going up his face, and it's not a personal attack. I mean, it's a constitutional professional observation. But he would get just crazy about that. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have to comment that this discussion really is, I can see how it could be a bit discouraging given the context of this program, trying to get associates in big Atlanta firms to take on these cases. Because what you're looking at is a second or third year associate in one of these big fancy Atlanta law firms going down to Bullock County and accusing some boy who's been practicing law in Bullock County for 30 years of being ineffective. How do we deal with that? How do we deal with that practical problem if we buy into this program that the Standards Council is asking us to buy into?
That's a really good question. Jiminy, do you have an
opportunity? That is my testimony. That is my song. Whenever I go out, and I was introduced to Jiminy Rogers, director of the Health Division, we go out all across the state, and we go down to different areas, and when they see you coming, known as the carpetbagger. And there's a lot of places in Georgia where it's obvious that I'm not from around there. And they know I'm coming, likely to raise ineffective assistance of counsel. And so part of that is you start out, you want to call the judge, you want to call the DA, say I'm coming down, you make friends over the phone, you play nice up front, and then you still have to deal with the issue of the trial counsel, who may say, at least I'm in the public defender system, who may say, you know, what are you doing down here raising this? And you do get that pushback sometimes.
Right.
But you really just have to do it. But sometimes you won't get it. You're graciously welcome. You may not be welcome on that court. And I've had a trial counsel tell me, I'll say, you know, whatever I need to say on the stand, but if you come after me aggressively, I'll growl at you.